And here's the biggest thing of the whole tutorial. It's the target bitrate number that you choose in the export settings window of Premiere Pro that will determine the overall quality of your final export. From the get-go, you probably want to use the same export settings as your sequence settings in Premiere Pro. Because if you're upscaling something that was shot in 1080p, edited in 1080p, but then exported at 4K, there's no reason to do that. Theoretically, you would be adding quote-unquote resolution, but you wouldn't be adding more detail. You'd just be making things bigger to fit into a 4K aspect ratio. But on the flip side, let's say you filmed everything in 4K, then you downscaled everything to 1080p and edited your sequence in 1080p, you'll want to export your sequence at 1080p. Now, the export will look so much better because you're filming in 4K and there's a whole bunch of added resolution there, as opposed to if you were filming in 1080p. But it doesn't work the other way around. You can't film in 1080p and then all of a sudden get like these even more high definition 4K
ultra high definition
files on export if you filmed in 1080p to upscale to 4K. So when in doubt, a good rule of thumb is to shoot, edit, and export with the same resolution, whether it be HD or 4K, as well as the same frame rate throughout the whole process. In the timeline, if you were to export a sequence like this, it would export the entire timeline. Now, if you're like me, you might have some B-roll over here to the side, and I don't want to export any of this. This is my main timeline. So what I like to do is highlight the clips that I want to export from the timeline, hit the question mark key, and that will set my in and out points, or these blue brackets right here, to the exact beginning and ending of those clips that you highlighted. Now, the physical duration of your video is defined by the in and out points. You can get rid of the in and out points by hitting Alt X. And if you wanted to customize and export a specific section of your sequence, you can always move the playhead to a certain spot, hit I to create your in point, and hit O to create the out point. And now if I were to export, it would only export what's inside this area. And if you ever have trouble remembering about how the in and out points work in terms of exporting, you can always think about it in terms of Lion King, and that everything that the grayish highlighted area touches is what will be exported. That's the best James Earl Jones impersonation you'll ever hear. Probably not. Moving on. To reach the export media window, you can go to File, Export, or you can hit Command M on Mac or Control M on Windows. Here inside the export settings for format, we're going to make sure it's H.264. Underneath this preset drop-down menu, it comes with YouTube 1080p Full HD presets and a 4K Ultra HD preset. So when in doubt, just use those and you probably be okay. Right now I'm gonna export at 1080p, and the reason being is because right here in the source, I can tell that my sequence is at 1920 by 1080. So it makes no sense for me to export at 4K. But if you shot in 4K and edited in 4K, then for sure, go ahead and export at 4K. Scrolling over the output name will tell you the file path of where your video is going to end up on your computer. All you have to do is click on it and save it as whatever you want to. I'm going to save this as Rough Cut V3. Make sure export video is checked and make sure export audio is checked. In the summary as well, if you want a quick reference, you can always make sure that, hey, this is 1920 by 1080 1.0. This is 1920 by 1080 1.0. Scrolling down, our width is 1920 by 1080 HD. I've never run into a project where I haven't used square pixels. I think the only other time that you wouldn't do that is if you were editing something in anamorphic. And if that's the case, you're probably looking at a different tutorial. Hardware encoding, profile is high, level is 4.2. And here's the biggest thing that you should remember about the whole tutorial in terms of quality exports from Premiere Pro. It's the target bitrate inside the encoder. Here's the quick breakdown on bitrate encoding. You have CBR, which stands for constant bitrate, and you have VBR, which stands for variable bitrate. As I understand it, if you were to use constant bitrate encoding, what would happen is, judging by this slider, so for this example, let's say 16, for every single second of your video file, it will devote 16 megabytes to it. Now that could be good or it could be bad depending on your situation, but in most circumstances, I don't think constant bitrate is the best option because it does not give you the variability to go to an extreme maximum bitrate for lots of action and everything going on, and then lower the bitrate for scenes like this where it's just a talking head and there really isn't any change in the pixels like behind me because it's just the same background the whole time. So for YouTube and for most other circumstances, I highly recommend using VBR or variable bitrate. If you do VBR one pass, this is really designated for those people that need to export something quickly and get it out of the door fast. Because what VBR one pass does is it does one pass of your sequence and exports it as is. To obtain the best quality though, you want to do VBR two pass. This is going to take a longer time to export because it's going to do two passes of your sequence. On the first pass, it's going to take an assessment of your sequence to better recognize how to render out your sequence on the second pass, meaning that it's going to go through and decide on all those busy parts like, hey, there's lots of pixels changing colors and dynamic range here. I need to devote more megabytes to this part. And then on the flip side, it's going to look at other dull parts and be like, oh, I don't need to designate as much time and effort to this part, and then implement all of those calculations better on the second pass. Which leads us to the most important slider of this whole tutorial, the target bitrate slider. You move it up and automatically you're going to get more quality, but you are going to get a much bigger file size, as you can see down here from the estimated file size. If I were to move this down, it changes the file size as I move the target bitrate slider. The other thing too is there's no reason for you to go above what your camera's recording bitrate is anyway. For example, my Sony a7 III will record at 50 megabytes per second when I'm shooting at 24 FPS 1080p HD. So there's really no reason for me to go above 50 megabytes per second because there's no new information there in the file. Plus, that's humongous. I think probably 0.000001% are going to tell the difference in your export if you were in the 40 to 50 megabytes per second range. The other thing that you have to take into consideration is the compression that happens from YouTube. So I don't know if this is true or not, but please let me know in the comments that if you upload too high resolution of a file, YouTube is actually going to compress that more than if you were to upload it at the proper settings that YouTube is looking for. So with that in mind, if you look at YouTube's website, as of the date of this upload, for HDR uploads, you would do something like 10 megabytes per second for 24, 25, and 30 frames, and 15 megabytes per second for those higher frame rate uploads. Those numbers go even higher for something like 4K. So right here, it says 44 to 56 megabytes for a standard frame rate file in 4K, or 66 to 85 megabytes per second for a high frame rate file. So to be on the safe side in the 1080p range, let's say it's something like this 15 megabytes per second. When you hit the YouTube Full HD preset in Premiere Pro, what they recommend doing is variable bitrate one pass at 16 megabytes per second, already 1 megabyte per second above the highest that they say for 1080p here on the YouTube website. So relating back to if you do have the time, I would highly suggest, in fact, you should probably do it, variable bitrate two pass to get better quality. Now the target bitrate is still at 16 and the maximum bitrate is at 16. But the great thing about having these two sliders now is that you can change the maximum bitrate to something bigger, just in case there's a lot of action happening on the screen. You can keep your target bitrate at 16, which is close to what YouTube was showing us, but then you can take your maximum bitrate and raise it to something like 20 or 25, or you could go to 50 if you wanted to. I mean, nobody's stopping you, but personally, I think that's still way too much. So what I like to do is something like 20, but it's really up to you. If you start noticing that your quality of your exports are better with a higher target bitrate, then by all means, if you have time to export things like that, then maybe do a higher target bitrate with a higher maximum bitrate. But if you really can't tell the difference with a smaller target bitrate and a smaller maximum bitrate, then I'm all for efficiency and speed and upload times. Again, target bitrate is the most important slider here. Advanced settings, I don't touch keyframe distance. VR video, I don't touch. The tabs for effects, multiplexer, captions, and publish, I don't touch at all. In audio, AAC, 48 kilohertz. Stereo, audio quality is high, obviously, and the bitrate is 320. And I take the precedence of bitrate in advanced settings. If you're looking for the best quality, obviously hit use maximum render quality. It's going to take longer in your export, but hey, it's there for a reason. For time interpolation, I use frame sampling. And before we head down to the export button, remember that you can always save these as a preset so you don't have to input this every single time. I'll have a download link to the exact presets that I've gone over in this video, but just remember that it is 1080p and it's at 23.976 frames per second. And if you hit Q, it will send it to Media Coder, and that will allow you to keep editing in Premiere Pro while it's exporting in the background. But if you only have one export, you can just hit export straight from Premiere Pro. Hit that like button if this has been helpful for you. Subscribe if you're new here and you're into video tech tutorials, gear reviews, or basically anything filmmaking. And there's probably another video on the screen right now about Premiere Pro or video tech that you want to click. If not, I hope you're out there living a life of abundance. I'll see you guys next time. For real though, please leave me a comment down below if this was helpful. Helps out the channel.